Welcome to Real Estate Roundup. I'm Emmanuel Romanis. We have a great show as always. We always have a great show for you folks. Today joining me is going to be John Walsh. He is the owner and president of Bethel Bakery, an institution for the past 60 years in Bethel Park and the South Hills area. And I'm very excited about that. As many of you know who saw the show last month, I celebrated our anniversary with a Bethel Bakery cupcake. In my opinion, as I've said 100 times, next to my daughter's, they're the greatest cupcakes on earth. And I'll go to my grave saying that. They're the best cupcakes on earth. So John's going to be joining us a little bit later. This show is going to be singular in focus. And really, it all came about by something that came in on the mailbag, or through the mailbag, I should say. And let me just get right to that. Betty from Peters Township is in the process of updating her kitchen. You know, she's looking at ovens and stoves and what have you, and there's just a myriad of choices out there. And she wanted to know what is the most expensive oven. And it got me thinking, and I thought, you know, I guess maybe I took this a little bit too far, but I really dug into this, and that's what this show is going to be about. It's going to be about ovens. And John being here from Bethel Bakery kind of dovetails a little bit into that as well. So it'll work. But what I discovered is on the non-commercial level, the La Cornue Grand Palais is the most expensive non-commercial oven that you can buy at $47,300. On the commercial end, Electrolux makes a model that starts at $103,000. So there you go. Pretty expensive to be sure. I also did some digging to go into the history of ovens. And anytime you want to find out history, a great place to go that I use often is the Smithsonian Institution. So their breakdown of the history of the oven goes like this. In ancient times, they were stone or brick fired with wood. Actually, upscale pizza shops still use a similar setup of oven that gets the crust real, real crispy. In colonial America, they switched over to a beehive-shaped brick oven with a door. Still fired with wood, but what this allowed was better control of oven temperature by either adding wood or opening the door to let cool air in. In the mid-1700s, cast iron became available. There was a single fire source, either wood or coal, but it could be regulated independently for multiple burners or multiple pots and could be used also to heat the home. The only drawback of the cast iron oven was its size. It was very, very big and took up a lot of space in the home. In 1802, the first recorded use of gas for cooking was documented, and it was by a Moravian named Zacchaeus Winsler. And in 1834, an Englishman named James Sharp developed the first commercially produced gas stove. In the late 1800s, shortly after the introduction of home electricity, electric stoves came into use. In 1892, an early model electric stove that was manufactured by Canadian Thomas Ahern was used to prepare an entire meal at the Windsor Hotel in Ottawa, Canada. And then finally, in 1954, the Raytheon Corporation produced the first commercial microwave oven. So pretty interesting. Again, it's one little question by Betty, and we developed a whole show around ovens, but that's the history of the oven. Now, that brings us to our section, Who Knew? Drawing a link between the development of agriculture and the invention of ovens, taking us back even further to the beginning, would be a logical assumption. Agriculture comes into play, ovens are developed, that way you can cook the food that you're processing. Yet, archaeological discoveries reveal something very different. The answer when we come back.
Hello, my name is John Bauer. I'm a paramedic supervisor with Tri-Community South EMS. I would like to tell you about hands-only CPR. If you see a teen or adult collapse, call or have someone call 911. Bare the victim's chest. Place one hand on the center of the chest and interlock both hands. Compress the chest fast and hard. Press 100 times a minute to the beat of the song Staying Alive. This will give you the correct rate for your compressions. Do this until EMS arrives. Stop CPR if you are too exhausted to continue. These two simple steps can double the person's chance for survival. Doing these steps can mean the difference between life and death. For more information on CPR training or our speakers bureau, go to tcsems.org or call 412-831-3710.
Emmanuel or Manny, okay. Whichever is easier for you.
Okay.
Yeah, I go by either. It doesn't matter.
Okay.
Okay, good deal. All right. Welcome back. Now, before the break, we were talking about the first known oven in existence. And according to the Harvard University Gazette, archaeologists have discovered in what is now considered modern-day Israel, very strong evidence that humans were refining wheat and barley into cereal and baking it in hearth-like ovens 23,000 years ago. That's 10,000 years before the development of agriculture. Who knew? Turning now to our guest, as I mentioned in the beginning of the program, I have with me John Walsh, who is the owner and president of Beloved Bethel Bakery. Now, for those of you who saw our show last month, which was our anniversary show, I celebrated with a Bethel Bakery cupcake. And, you know, I've said it many times and I'll say it again. Next to my daughter's cupcakes, of course, she puts in the love that Bethel Bakery doesn't put in specifically for me. But next to my daughter's cupcakes, Bethel Bakery's cupcakes, in my opinion, are the best on the planet. I just love them, and I thought it was very appropriate that we would bring John in. That way we could speak to him more about Bethel Bakery, the history, what they do, and just how they do it. So, John, welcome to the program.
Well, thank you, Mia. It's a pleasure to be here, and If your daughter wants a behind-the-scenes tour of the bakery, and maybe she's the future baker of America, we'd love to have her come back and see how we do it at the Bethel Bakery level anyways.
That would be awesome. I just may take you up on that. Now, John, let's start at the beginning. You're the owner, president, founder, CEO. You're Bethel Bakery, in a nutshell. How did you start?
Okay. Well, I am the owner, but my parents are the founders of the
bakery.
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
My parents started the bakery in 1955.
Okay.
So last year we celebrated our 60th anniversary, which
nice.
Was a great, great celebration.
That's awesome.
And I'm just really excited that my parents were and still are very viable, very active, and very much a part of our celebration last year.
Oh, that's wonderful. Now, do they still pop down to the shop every once in a while, or are they pretty much hands off?
Oh, yes. My dad, you never know. If it's a rainy day, you never know if he might pop in and decide to make some pineapple bran muffins or some whole wheat bread for my mother, because they were particular favorites for my mother, but not necessarily customer favorites.
Got it.
So
got it.
He comes in and makes something like that for her. And He likes to golf, so it's usually if we see him, it's on a rainy day.
Oh, man. So, like today.
Yeah, like today. Yeah.
That is awesome. Now, you're located down on Brightwood Road. Is that where you started, or where was the first Bethel Bakery?
The first Bethel Bakery was on South Park Road.
Okay.
If you leave the bakery and you make a left, you go down to the intersection
yes.
of Brightwood and South Park,
right.
and you make a left. And before you come to the barber shop, halfway up the hill, there's a few garages there.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Well, they started in there.
I'll be darned.
There was three garages, and one was his supply room.
Okay.
One was his production room.
All right.
And then one was the sales room.
I'll be darned. Now, when was it that you moved into the bigger location where you're at now?
Well, they were there on South Park Road for 3 years.
Okay.
And then Leonard Tischler approached my dad and said, hey, I'm thinking about putting a bakery in up here. Are you interested?
Okay.
Well, my dad didn't want to have a competitor around the block from him, so he jumped on the opportunity to get onto Brightwood Road.
Oh, nice. And you've been there ever since.
Right. Now, okay. on South Park Road, they had parking for one or two cars.
Right.
So this was the big... a big jump for him, and he said that business like doubled like overnight just by having a more access to parking
okay.
and maybe more visibility too.
Now, as far as just this is a real estate show, and just to make it a little more relevant to the show itself, as far as square footage, how much is allocated to baking, to the retail space, how did you or your dad figure that out? Or it was just a matter of, this is the space that we have, come fill it how you want?
Well, when he first moved in there, I don't know how he delineated how much was going to be production and how much was going to be sales.
Okay.
I do know that they thought they would never have a need for all the space that they had in the production end. And I can remember my dad saying that Clara Sidek, who is a Bethel Park resident, that he actually learned his mixing trade from when he started back in Dutz Bakery in Mount Lebanon when he was in high school.
Oh, okay.
She said to him, I'm just walking too much here. This is because before it was just like you turned around and you were everywhere you wanted to be.
Right.
It was so small.
Okay.
But she was complaining like, this is just too much walking.
Okay.
And, but I'm not sure how that developed, but I do know that currently I would say it's probably 30% retail, 70%. Production area.
Okay. Now, have you altered that over the years toward demand, or has it pretty much been stable 70-30 mix as far as space is concerned?
Well, we've added on to both over the years.
Okay.
Both has changed because when my dad first moved up there, he had so much space, and then eventually he added some space. There was Andy's Shoe Service was next to him.
Right,
and
right.
And he took that over.
Okay.
And then we took over space on the back end of the bakery.
Okay.
And still, this was all Tischler,
right.
owned by the Tischler family.
Right.
And then back in the fall of 92, there was a fire in the plaza.
Oh,
we had Barker's Meats was right next door to
us. I remember Barker's.
Yes.
Is that where the fire was?
It was, they sustained the brunt of the fire.
Okay.
It actually started in the basement. There was, it was electrical.
Okay.
Based on a storm that we had and lightning. So after the fire, Barker's Meats opted not to return.
Mm-hmm.
And then a year later, we negotiated with Tischler's to take that space over. So we more than doubled our retail space by moving over there. And the old store became, more refrigeration, freezer space, and production space.
Gotcha. Okay.
And then... So that was in like 93 when we took that space over that was formerly occupied by Barker's Meats.
Okay, got it.
And then 5 years ago, we 4 or 5 years ago, we took over the space that was formerly occupied by Sinello Insurance Agency, mm-hmm. and also Vito's Tailor Shop.
Okay, so you've expanded quite a bit over the years.
Yes, but the last expansion was due to the fact that we were able to purchase the building from Tischer Brothers.
Oh, okay.
And so that, you know, precipitated our expansion. And
so you own the whole complex now?
Right.
Oh, that's
right.
Wonderful. Good right. for you. That's great.
So that's why we, you know, developed the Cake Place concept.
Right.
And then we moved our wedding department into its own separate area, which
okay.
which has been a good thing because millennials and just that, particularly that part
sure.
of our business, the experience is just as important as the product.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely.
So it's been a really good thing.
Oh, that's wonderful. That is wonderful. Let's talk a little bit because the theme of this show happens to be ovens. Now, obviously, you don't use pizza ovens, which most people, you know, when they walk into a shop, they see a big oven. For the type of products that you produce, what type of ovens do you use? And not necessarily name brands or anything like that, but is it basically just a commercial end of what people know as the oven they have at home, or is it special type of ovens? What do you use to make the cupcakes and cakes and what have you?
Well, when my dad first started out, he had a deck oven, like a pizza oven.
Okay. Oh, really?
You know,
okay.
You know, like I believe it had four shelves to it. We have a picture of it down at the bakery.
Okay.
Like four drawers.
Right.
And so he baked everything in that.
Oh, okay.
You know, for
okay.
the first 3 years, everything was baked in a pizza oven.
I'll be darned. I would have never yeah. thought that they would be contusive yeah. to each other.
Now, it is clearly better for pies and things like that than it is for cakes, but you certainly can make it work.
Okay.
Just a little bit more work,
right?
But
right.
You know, more turning and keeping an eye on it.
Okay.
But we have two ovens at the bakery, so everything is done in two ovens.
Okay.
And actually, maybe it was only about 8 years ago that we, up until that point, we only had one oven.
Really, everything was done out of one oven.
One oven. And what happened one day was we had one baker. Put his notice in, and I thought to myself, I am not going to be able to find someone as quick and as thorough and as good as Ben.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I have to find a way to, you know, through some kind of equipment,
right,
and make sure that we can still pump out the same amount of product at the same quality level.
Okay.
And really, we had to get another oven.
Got it.
And got a different oven, the oven that we do most of the baking in mm-hmm. is a rotary oven. It's like a big Ferris wheel inside.
Oh, okay.
Okay, it has five shelves, and you can put six full sheet pans on each shelf.
Okay.
So that's why they call it a 30-pan oven.
Something similar to when you go to, say, Giant Eagle, you see the rotisserie chicken going
right.
around in a circle, something
right.
along that line?
Right.
Okay,
right.
Got it.
But this is you know, a pretty big oven.
Right.
You figure you can get six full sheet pans on one shelf, and then you have a man door at the end that you
okay.
can go in there and service the oven.
That's
so
huge. All right.
It takes up a good bit of space. But the oven that we got after that is a rack oven, and those are the kind of ovens that you might see at Panera or something like that.
Okay,
where
got
they
it.
Roll the whole rack in.
Right.
So it saves you all that loading and unloading time.
Okay. Okay.
But then it makes Christmas possible for us
because all right.
we're able to bake 40 trays of cookies at one time,
all right.
roll them in, roll them out, and it just saves.
That makes you know, sense.
Makes Christmas manageable.
Now, as far as obviously you have freezers, refrigerators, things of that nature. What about just storage space? Do you just have racks? Because I imagine when you make things, everything doesn't automatically go into a freezer or refrigerator. You also have a section where you just have racks of product, or.
Well, once the product comes out, say if it's a cupcake,
mm-hmm.
You know, they're de-panned and cold. We will put them out in the store. We will, you know, some go to decorating, mm-hmm. some go to orders right away. But there's, it just depends. Like, we have one account out in McMurray Dairy Bar, mm-hmm. now the Heister's Market.
Right.
And we deliver to them daily.
Okay.
And, but you're right, we do have an area in the production room where there's a lot of our supplies.
Okay.
And so we have to be careful, because sometimes if you pull a rack out of the oven and it's hot, you don't know a hot rack from a not hot rack.
Right.
So we'll put a tag on it that it's a hot rack and that. So, but that's, you okay. know, basically the process. We try and get it in the store as quickly as we can.
Okay. Now, as far as you deliver special orders, I know I've ordered many things over the years from Bethel Bakery, and also you have the retail cases where you can just walk in and buy a cupcake, which is what I did before I came to the show last month. What is the breakdown, John, as far as just walk-in retail as opposed to special orders and deliveries and things of that nature, as far as your business? You know, how much of it is walk-in as opposed to special orders?
Well, 80% of our sales is generated, is right over that counter.
Really? That high?
That's 80% of our sales happens over the counter.
Okay.
And the 20% is either from a wholesale account like Heister's Market
right.
in Peters Township, McGinnis Sisters,
okay.
or the accounts that we have through Wedding Cakes, because mm-hmm. we are the wedding cake vendor for a number of area, you know, venues.
Right,
and
right.
So that's not happening over the counter kind of
right.
thing, but being delivered.
I would have never thought that the over counter would have been that much of your business. That's remarkable. Now, the wedding end, have you seen consistent growth in that area since you started that?
That's probably the area that we have the most growth in.
Okay.
Over the years, that's definitely where we're seeing double-digit growth in the last few years.
That's phenomenal.
We give, you know, excellent service,
mm-hmm.
and they have a great experience, and the service is followed all the way through delivery and
right.
keeping a good relationship with our, you know, all of our accounts.
What is your most unique wedding cake that you've done?
Well, I guess the most unique wedding cake is whatever the bride is looking for. You know, we don't ever say this is our most unique wedding cake, I wouldn't think, because as soon as we say that, the next bride comes in with something that's more
right,
unique, you know.
Right, right, right.
But it's always customizing it to
okay.
what their venue, whatever they want, whatever
right.
it's all their day. They
right.
they say, this is what I'm thinking, and we say, yes, we can do it.
And all the decoration and that is done in-house as well, correct?
Right. Everything is done in-house.
Okay.
I mean, everything is baked on the premises. At the moment, we do have a off-site warehouse
mm-hmm.
that we store some of our packaging
right, okay.
supplies at. But we're even going to consolidate that by the end of the year.
Okay. How many employees does Bethel Bakery have at the moment?
Between full-time and part-time, about 85.
Oh, okay. Oh, wow. That's a lot bigger than I thought.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah, we have probably about 60-40.
Okay.
About 60% part-time, 40% full-time.
That's wonderful. Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, this has been very fascinating. I'm glad that I had a chance to meet you. Before we leave, is there anything else that you'd like to tell the listeners, or maybe that we haven't touched on that you think is relevant that they should know about Bethel Bakery?
Well, I'm just so appreciative of our clientele, because I do realize that everybody's most precious resource is their time.
Sure.
And for them to take, you know, a special stop to come to us, because really, there's really nothing else at our plaza.
Mm-hmm.
You know, years ago when there was
right.
Barker's Meats and, you know, a hair salon and maybe a years ago, before that, a drugstore.
Mm-hmm.
So we just, you know, our goal is to really make sure that they know that their visit, that we appreciate their visit, and to give them the best quality and service we can. And we're really appreciative of the place and the position that we have in the community of being such a community-based business. And I always say anybody could be our customer. You know, even if you are a diabetic, you could still buy for somebody else.
Well, you know, that's a good thing that you bring up, because gluten-free is a big thing now. Do you have a gluten-free menu that you can offer customers?
We do carry the gluten-free products through Gluteny.
Okay.
We have them right prepackaged right in our store. We did give serious consideration to that program as part of our bakery, but the best way to run that is really to have a separate facility so that it can be so you can guarantee that there's no cross contact or cross contamination.
Because I guess even if you try to make it gluten free, if you're using the same mixing bowls or what have you, there's a possibility of cross contamination. Is that what you're speaking of?
Right. I mean, like I said, the best way is to have a separate facility.
Okay.
And in order to do that, you're talking about separate ovens, separate kitchen.
Gotcha. Okay.
You know, a lot of resources to do that.
Okay.
And not knowing just how much that's really going to generate, it was easier to, you know, carry their product
right.
because usually it's one of those things where if you're having a party, there might be someone that is gluten-free. You can still pick up something for them at the bakery while you're picking up the cake, and then at least
that
they
makes
can
sense.
Have a dessert or a treat.
The bottom line is it's available at your store.
Right.
Fantastic. Well, John, thank you very much. Here's to another 60 years. Bethel Bakery, a keystone in this area. Everything they do is top-notch, first class, but the cupcakes, bar none, the best in the world, next to my daughter's. We'll be right back.
I've shown an interest in making home movies. Me and some buddies would just grab a camera and just start making these videos, and then you realize at some point that this isn't just a hobby anymore. It's something that you actually want to pursue, and there's this great facility right down the road, BPTV. A lot of people will try to do these productions on their own, and one of the things they don't have is the equipment, you know. But right here is everything she needs in one nice little bundle. There's lights, cameras, reflectors, dollies, all kinds of little knickknacks, like anything that you'd want to use that you would need for a production, you have it right here. Like, it's all right here. You can make your own feature movie just with the stuff from this studio. Come meet Dave Cable, let him show you around, and I think you'll realize that this is something that you could fall into regardless of your level of expertise, whether you're a beginner or even if you're a more advanced learner. There's something here for everyone, and I feel that you just need to come through and just be a part of the experience and just watch and learn, and, you know, let Dave be your guide.
Welcome back. Okay, that's our show. I hope you enjoyed it, and we'll see you next month. Thanks for watching.